Welcome to Dual Redundancy, the only podcast turned supernatural elimination service where you can hear all the latest in television and entertainment news with two hosts with exactly the same opinions. I'm one of those hosts, David Allen, and the other one is...
John Berwick.
Wait, what? John Berwick?
Yep, I'm here.
John, you're supposed to be behind the scenes. You're supposed to be, never seen, never heard. This is supposed to be Mike and I at Dual Redundancy. What's going on this week?
I am here to fill in for Mike while he's, busting ghosts.
Oh, busting ghosts, yes. John is a probably the biggest Ghostbusters fan that I know. And in honor of the 30th anniversary of Ghostbusters this year, we decided to do something a little different this week on Dual Redundancy. Instead of doing some TV and entertainment talk with Mike, we're going to break down this movie and talk all about Ghostbusters with two super fans. Now, we already got a question. We're going to jump into questions here, John.
Sure.
Start you right off here with one. This user wrote, at Mike TV Ladue writes, who's the new guy? So, John, you're kind of new to the podcast, to the listeners, not to us, because every week you obviously do audio work for us. You want to do a little quick bio, who you are, and, you know, what makes Ghostbusters your cup of tea?
Sure. Well, as many of you know, I went to school with Dave and Mike, and I remember way back, what was it, 3 years ago now? 4 years? Almost four, right?
I think it's been almost three.
I remember sitting down with you and doing our first little Is This Possible test I believe it was up in Mike's room. But anyway, I don't know. Ghostbusters was one of those movies that when he first saw it, it really captured my attention. Mm-hmm. And it was the same with Back to the Future, which I know you're a big fan of. Yeah. But something about it is just almost timeless, even though it's clearly not from right now, but you know, it's everything, it's so relatable, you know.
Oh,
and of course it's ridiculous because, you know, we don't go around seeing ghosts, but most people don't, but it's a bunch of dorky guys being the heroes, you know.
No, definitely. And it really is timeless. These, you know, Ghostbusters turning 30 this year, Back to the Future turning 30 next year. These movies, while, you know, very sci-fi, one's about time travel, one's about, you know, busting up ghosts, they still have a great story underneath all the sci-fi and fantasy. And, yeah, it really captures, I think, the imagination of, well, us as kids, because we saw it, you know, on a VHS, you know, when we were young. We weren't alive for this movie to see it in theaters. And, and I think it still holds up today. It's still hilarious. So many great lines, so many great things about this.
The way they created it, it was so plausible the whole time that, you could just feel like you're going to walk down the street tomorrow and see, just the Stay Puft Marshmallow Man tearing down a building or something. It's going to happen. It's just a matter of time.
Yeah, just a normal Tuesday. There's a Stay Puft Marshmallow Man. And then on every other Friday, I just see a DeLorean drive by and think nothing of it. Yeah, yep. So what we're going to do on this podcast is we're going to break down this movie, you know, scene by scene. We're going to put a disclaimer up front. Some of these questions are probably just absurd, and everyone's going to be like, why are you nitpicking this classic? And, I mean, we could just talk about all day how great this movie is, but, you know, we're going to try to add a little humor to kind of these, you know, things that maybe on a second or third rewatch that you're like, wait a minute. But we're all just, it's all in good fun. We're just, you know, having a good time here picking on, you know, a classic movie. And I'll put another disclaimer. Check out this audio on YouTube. John usually sends me two files of this, one for iTunes and one for YouTube. The iTunes one, you know, it's smaller, not as high quality as the YouTube one. So if you're already listening and you're like, man, this sounds terrible, go over to YouTube. It's there and it sounds crystal clear, I promise.
Please.
Mm-hmm. All right. So let's start off with some basics, you know, some straight up facts about this movie. So yeah, as we said, it came out 1984, June 8th, so we're just over 30 years ago. It was made on a $25 million budget, and it opened number one. It was number one for 7 weeks, and it made $238 million domestic, $53 million foreign, so for $291 million total. I'm a little surprised, only $50 million over the foreign box office. Maybe they just couldn't grasp the concept of ghostbusting. Well, these numbers are also low because of inflation. You know, maybe the 53 million tickets were only like 10 cents overseas. But if we adjusted that number for inflation, the total box office goes from 291 to 563 million for the 33rd highest grossing movie of all time. And then if we're looking at just 1984, the year it came out, it was second for the year, just behind Beverly Hills Cop. It just needed 5 million more, but it was above Temple of Doom and The Gremlins, The Karate Kid. 1984 was a pretty good year for movies. That's just the top five right there, and all five of those are classics. So, you know, to stand out between all of them says a lot about Ghostbusters.
Oh, for sure. It's timeless.
Timeless. There you go, John. So, yeah, before we get to the film, maybe some development, you know, like what they were originally thinking about with this film. Dan Aykroyd, I guess the brains behind this operation, he was fascinated with the paranormal, and that led him to try to create this vehicle for him, and was originally supposed to be John Belushi. They were supposed to travel through space, time, and other dimensions. There's going to be wands instead of proton packs. It was going to be pretty more sci-fi and fantasy than what we actually saw.
Yeah, and you know, I know we recently both watched it, and I watched it with the commentary on just to shake things up. And they noted that as they were refining it, they kind of referred to them as firemen who run around trying to catch ghosts, which I think kind of lends itself to the pack and the uniform being the way they are.
Yeah, and it also works great. You know, obviously they work in a fire station. It's kind of like, oh, just another call to get ghosts, and it's like sliding down the pole, putting on the uniform, grabbing your pack, and it's a very kind of like a, you know, for New York, you know, there's always pride in the fire department, the police department, NYPD, that whole thing. And it was just, you know, add that to the list. The Ghostbusters were, you know, in that trifecta of keeping New York safe. And when he pitched this to Ivan Reitman, who is the director of the film, he just saw, the budget for this was going to be completely impractical with what Dan Aykroyd was thinking, you know, with this different dimensions and all that stuff. So they did a complete script overhaul for 3 weeks. They got into a Martha's Vineyard bomb shelter, and you know, for 3 weeks, I don't know if there was any breaks, if they got up to see, you know, like the sun for this, but for 3 weeks they tinkered away and came up with, you know, what we ended up seeing, or at least a version of that, because I'm sure a lot of this film was still tweaked and ad-libbed and stuff like that.
Yeah, from what I hear, that's not super uncommon for writers to just sit down and block everything out, but it's still cool.
That's how actually this podcast was made. Like 3 weeks ago, we were going to do a whole podcast on Ghostbusters 2, and then we sat down for 3 weeks, we locked ourselves in a closet, and we just tinkered away at this rundown, and we decided to completely change it all up. Yeah. All right, so here we go, John. Let's start off, you know, let's get to this movie finally. And, you know, we're going to go scene by scene and, you know, pick out some fun moments that we saw. The film starts off, we're at the New York Public Library, or at least the exterior of it.
Yep.
And an old librarian is putting some books back in the basement and, you know, is later spooked by a ghost, which we don't see originally. Now, one of the cool things about this opening is some of the effects. You got books flying, you know, going back and forth. But to this day, one effect that I still can't understand is this card catalog thing, just all the cards going up. And I know you're a physics guy, you know. Can you explain this at all, how this worked? Because I don't understand it.
Yeah, they actually went over it in the commentary. What they ended up doing is they laid some copper tubing down underneath the cards, and they drilled holes in it. I'm guessing they had some kind of stopper inside of it, so as they put compressed air through it, it would move that stopper and let more and more cards blow out. And I believe they said it was a completely fake wall and that they just had a whole bunch of people behind there to push the card catalogs out of the shelf and then compressed air.
Yeah, I was going to say, like, it's so cool to see, like, practical effects like that. And, you know, because those are the things I think spark our imagination. Is like, if it feels like this thing could actually happen. There was no CGI, like, for that moment. We actually saw those cards, you know, fly up, and it looked real, you know, to this day. It's really amazing.
Well, it looked real because it was real, you know?
Well, yeah, there you go.
Their explanation wasn't, you know, it wasn't a ghost, but it was still real.
Mm-hmm. All right, so now we're going to move in, and we're going to see Peter Venkman, played by Bill Murray. He's at his office. His door says, burn in hell. You know, someone wasn't happy with him, and he's doing a test. He's doing a test, you know, to figure out if someone's psychic or not. He has a male and a female. He's having them read those cards. Now, I'm trying to figure out, was this at all a real test? And that the girl comes in signing up for the test, and then Bill Murray sees him and is trying to hit on her, or was it this was whole a ruse to begin with, and he just got like this student to come in because he wanted to get with her?
I don't think it matters either way for the story, because it just sets up his character and how much of like a corn dog kind of guy he is, you know, going after the girl and putting down the other guy. But I could see him rigging the cards and pairing the two of them up just to be able to give the guy a couple zaps and for his amusement and for hers.
Yeah, it does say a lot about the character. A great line from this film later on is Sigourney Weaver says, "You don't remind me of a doctor. You remind me of a game show host." And that's, I think, Peter Venkman. He's kind of like this off, like kind of used car salesman, just trying to, you know, pull tricks on everyone. But the thing is, the kid, the male, even though he keeps getting shocked, he actually gets a card right. So was
the wavy lines.
Yeah, was this test? Does he actually have ESP? Maybe the test was, hey, if you shock someone many, many times, that triggers them to clear their minds and have ESP. Maybe Venkman had something here.
I suppose it's possible, but how many did he get wrong up until that point? Wasn't it like 4 or 5?
It's not positive reinforcement. Was it negative?
Yeah.
That's what he was doing. Yeah. But either way, we find out the real effect, and that brings us to one of our quotes. We're going to go through, pick out some quotes, and then at the end, we're going to try to, you know, name off the top 3 or 4 quotes from the film. But here's one of the nominees already. The effect of this whole experiment, and he says, "I'll tell you what the effect is. It's pissing me off." Which I thought was a really great line already.
Yeah, right off the bat and starting the movie strong. Yeah.
All right, so now Bill Murray wasn't the first choice to be a Peter Venkman. Originally, this was a vehicle for John Belushi, but of course, because of his death, he wouldn't be able to do this. And other names that were thrown into the hat, Michael Keaton, Chevy Chase. Now, I don't know. Was this an upgrade or a downgrade? You know, looking back on it, was Bill Murray, of course, the perfect choice for this role?
You know what? I couldn't imagine it without Bill Murray.
Yeah.
So that's too tough of a call to say upgrade or downgrade. I think that it's one of those things that it happened, and it maybe it happened for a reason. Maybe it was chance. But now that it's happened, we're not going to fool with it. You know?
Yeah. I definitely think so. Like, it would be interesting to see what, you know, Belushi, Keaton, Chase, all these guys would have done with the character. But, you know, Bill Murray, he's taken on a whole life of his own now, just of his persona today. But even then, you know, the 80s were him. Like, comedy and 80s, like, those are in the same sentence between, you know, this movie and Stripes and obviously Saturday Night Live and all the other stuff he was doing, you know. They couldn't have, I think, picked a better person, you know, as a second choice or whatever he was to Belushi. I think, you know, we'll get to the sequel talk later. A Ghostbusters film without Bill Murray is not a Ghostbusters film, in my opinion.
No, that's 100% correct.
Mm-hmm. All right, so now we're going to go back to the library because, well, there's a ghost now, and we gotta bust it, or we gotta figure out what's going on here. So, we first get introduced to Egon here, played by Harold Ramis, and they actually gloss over something that I didn't even really notice. But Murray says, you know, this is like the time you tried drilling holes in your head, and Egon's like, yeah, that would have worked if you didn't stop me. They just gloss over this entire fact that this guy was drilling holes in his head or trying to. So, I don't know, maybe we should just gloss over that too on the podcast. We should not even mention it again, but already you can tell something's off with, you know, Egon and this whole group.
They're just laying down that backstory, you know, of they're slightly off, but still lovable, you know?
Yeah, the oddballs, like the Revenge of the Nerds almost here.
Yeah.
All right, so we get to interrogate this woman that saw the ghost downstairs, and this leads to another line here, this one from Peter Venkman. He's asking him, you know, like all these questions to her. He's like, oh, are you currently menstruating? And the guy's like, you know, what's that got to do with it? And he just goes, back off, man, I'm a scientist. And to this day I use that line quite often when anyone, you know, says something just completely random to me. It's like, you know, oh, why are you gonna do that? And I'm just like, back off, man, I'm a scientist. It has nothing to do with science, nothing to do with anything. I love that line.
It's a great, not space filler, but a good comeback when you need one.
Definitely. All right, so they go downstairs. There's now ectoplasm all over the cards. And, you know, obviously a ghost was around here. But the thing I'm more curious about is this vertical book stacking. The books are just, you know, stacked up in the middle of the hallway here. I don't understand I understand. Okay, this is creepy. You know, this is weird. But at the same time, what was the ghost doing to these books? Like, why did he put the ghost in that stack like that?
I don't know. You'd think for a ghost which lives in a library, which I'm assuming was a past librarian probably, would be a little neater with all the books. But, you know, maybe that's the point of a ghost, is not to be what you were.
Yeah, I mean, because it's weird, because the librarian later shushes them, so she's still keeping up with the rules, you know, the library, don't do this, don't do that. But then at the same time, she's throwing the card catalog everywhere, you know, the books are stacked, she's knocking down bookcases. It's very strange. She goes back and forth here, but I just think it's funny that it's like, you know, I'm trying to get myself in the mind of these ghosts. And, you know, if I was a ghost, I'm like, here's how I'll scare him off. I'm going to stack the books vertically. That'll get him. It's just like, okay, strange slop, but we'll try it.
Maybe it was more of a warning.
Yeah. Yeah. If you see what I can do with these books, wait till you see what I do with you.
Yeah.
All right. All right. So they find her now, but now it gets to a point, it's like, what do we do? They don't know what to do. So they, you know, they try a couple different things, and then finally, Ray, Dan Aykroyd's character, just goes, "Get her!" and just yells, and they get terrified by the ghost. Obviously, it doesn't work out, and they just run out. Now, they never come back to this library in the film. Do we ever catch this ghost? Because, you know, I mean, there's a montage later in the film, but if not, this ghost is still terrorizing this library.
Well, I know. Back in high school, when I was in high school, so I don't know, maybe it's been almost 6 or 7 years now, they released a Ghostbusters game for, you know, Xbox 360 and the PS3, and you actually do go back to the library and capture this librarian ghost one point. So there's this little closure from an offshoot, but it's something.
Yeah, I know it's just like, you know, like a one-off joke, you know, they have to introduce something here, but... You know, yeah, just, it's cool that they went back to this and kind of closed up any, you know, lingering plot lines, even though it is really small. But, so they run away, they end up going back to the office there at the college, but it turns out they're being kicked out. You know, there's no more funding for their grant. Now, here's my question. You know, like, why are they getting kicked out right now? Was it possibly the guy that they were shocking? He kept shocking him so much, he was so pissed off that he turned him into the dean. Is that plausible?
That sounds like it could be part of it, but I think that might be the straw that broke the camel's back, as they say. You know, mm-hmm. everything, the dean is getting kind of pissed off with them, you know, just kind of not exactly using the space for whatever research they're supposed to be doing, but using it for torturing people.
do we know what they're actually supposed to be doing? Like, are they actually commissioned to be making like some paranormal kind of investigation, or is that just kind of their own freelance stuff that they're supposed, like, because even Ray is like, you know, we didn't have to do anything, we didn't have to produce anything. But from what I understand with like the whole college system, it's like professors have to, you know, at least at like Ithaca, I thought, had to, you know, write papers every so often or produce a work, you know, and, you know, during their downtime they would have to be constantly working on something in their field to show results, you know, that they're still working and not just coasting through college. So, like, do we know anything about what they were actually supposed to be doing?
I'm not sure. I for some reason, I feel like they were doing something in, not exactly like psychic stuff, but something in that area where they, you know, obviously that would lend to the ESP test, but psychic and the study of how the mind works. That word is escaping me.
Yeah, like how their mind works when a drill is being drilled into their head.
Yeah.
Okay. Maybe that was the test that they if they did that test, then maybe the dean would let them stay. It's like, oh, well, you did work on that. You found no results, so, but at least you're trying.
Yeah.
All right. So so they're getting kicked out. They need to find something else to do. So they decide, you know, to try this, you know, this paranormal capturing idea. So they go to the bank, and it looks like Ray, like, I think mortgages like a house, or he does something here. But even it looks like a completely bad idea, because even Egon was saying the interest on this alone for 5 years, it was like $95,000, which I looked up, 2014. Want to take a guess at how much that is?
Oh, no, I don't even want to try.
$217,000.
Oh, man.
And that was just interest for 5 years? Like,
oh, man.
He's no wonder why this guy wants to make 3 or 4 more Ghostbusters movies. Like,
yeah.
He's in the hole here. But,
wow.
But it makes me wonder, where are, you know, Peter and Egon putting their money in? Are they not contributing to this business? So if in that case, Ray should get 100% of the profits. Well, maybe not 100, because I'm sure Egon is doing some, you know, research and stuff for the equipment. But how come they're not ponying up, putting some money in?
I think this goes back to Peter's character again, how he's kind of a corn dog and a conniver, and he sees that, you know, he could talk him into, you know, mortgaging the house or whatever he needs to do to get the money to fund them. And you know, it's not that he's trying to screw a friend, but mm-hmm. that he sees an out that doesn't inconvenience him.
Yeah. Well, it's also weird that they choose him of all people, because Ray, as we later see in the film, is just a terrible, terrible spender with his money. Like, they go to the firehouse to see if it works or not. Egon says a whole list of problems. He doesn't even negotiate. He's like, oh, this pole works? I'm taking it.
He wants it just for the fire pole.
Yeah. And then later he comes up with the car, you know.
Yeah.
And Murray's like, oh, you can't park that here. And he's like, oh, I found the car. It just has this, that, and the other wrong. And it's like, what are you doing wasting all your money on things that just need so much fixing? Like, who fixed up all this stuff? Like, I saw him working on the car, but did they just clean up the fire station themselves here? Like,
I'm guessing. I mean, they seem to be handy enough to make all sorts of equipment out of colanders and stuff later in the movie, so I'm guessing they have a couple skills under their belt.
I don't know, but I think that icing on the cake of this whole thing here is later they're struggling. They have no more petty cash. They're eating Chinese food for like the Last Supper here, and the camera pulls out, and we see that there's three like video game consoles that you would see like an arcade just sitting up there. Who bought these? Because if Ray bought these, I'm just gonna like slap him across the head.
That was exactly what I was gonna say. I feel like Ray was just like, "Oh, we need these," and you know, they need them. You know,
I and you know what? Probably they were all like busted up too. They were all busted up, and you know, he didn't get any deal on them, and like probably Egon had to fix them all anyways.
Yeah,
just to top it off, but. I don't know. Speaking of being probably too expensive for all this stuff, the next scene is Dana Barrett. We go to her apartment here. First of all, we actually see it from a gargoyle's perspective, which I've actually, you know, on a rewatch, there's a lot of this. You know, at the public library, it starts off with the lions, you know, out front there. You know, later on in the film, we see more of these, like, kind of gargoyle statue things. And then, obviously, that pulls into a plot point later in the film.
Yeah. It sure does.
Yeah. I mean, you didn't have to say anything there. I just wanted to point that out, that, you know, there's little, like, foreshadows here throughout the film. Including the Stay Puft marshmallows, right? Like, when she comes home with the groceries here. She puts them right out on the counter, and, you know, obviously that comes back. And another thing I noticed was when the roof explodes at the end, there's a billboard for Stay Puft Marshmallows. So I think you see stuff like this. You know, we talked about Back to the Future earlier. There's, like, little things throughout the film that if you actually stop and pause, you know, there's this BuzzFeed article that just came out where it's, like, the one thing in Back to the Future that you never notice, and it's the whole thing with the Twin Pines and the Lone Pine Mall, because he drives over the pine tree when he goes to 1955. You know, I think I saw that, you know, the first or second time when I watched it, but either way, it's like little details like that that it shows that the filmmakers care, so then it makes it, you know, I think like a believable world, a complete story, and, you know, Ghostbusters also did it as well.
Yeah, and it gives you something to look at the next time you watch it, you know. Definitely. A little, you can always piece that puzzle together a little bit better every time you watch it.
Mm-hmm. So, so how I got on this tangent was, we're talking about things being expensive here. This apartment that Dana Barrett owns is a penthouse apartment on Central Park West. Now, from what I understand, that is one of probably the most expensive apartments in all of the world, let alone New York City. Like, it's super expensive, especially for a musician. I saw a post online that said someone in 2012, someone in the New York Philharmonic would make about $91,000 a year. So not even close.
No, nowhere near.
To maybe a month's payment on this apartment. So maybe she had some, you know, dying family member that, you know, left her this place or something, because
she must have.
Yeah. It's, I don't know where she's getting all that money. Unless she's working with Ray and the legal team that he has. Yeah. She's just mortgaging all this stuff, and she has interest on this apartment. She's not going to pay it off until 2036 or something, but.
Yeah, it was a real fixer-upper, right?
Yeah, fixer-upper, yeah. Well, at the end of the movie, it's certainly going to be a fixer-upper. Yeah. Oh, man. So she's going into the apartment here, and we get to meet Louis Tully, played by Rick Moranis. Now, originally, it was supposed to be John Candy. Do you have any details of why he didn't want to do it?
Yeah, watching the commentary again, they noted that he didn't really understand what the part was supposed to be, who he was supposed to play, and they mentioned that he wanted to have a German accent and have a whole bunch of Rottweilers and all this stuff, but, you know, they told him no, because there was enough dogs in the film at that point, yeah. You know, so he ended up turning it down, and I guess they said that Rick had received a copy of the script to read and was just waiting quietly until he heard that John had said no, and then just jumped in and said, I'll do it. Well, he wanted it.
Again, I mean, I'm not, I guess I haven't seen too much of John Candy to really know his, you know, comedic power. Same with, for me, I haven't seen too much of John Belushi to know. So to picture anyone else besides Rick Moranis in this part is just crazy to me. Because, you know, even though he's playing the, you know, probably stereotypical nerd, at the same time, what he does with this is just, it's just hilarious. Like, I think he's, you know, I think, you know, if you look at the billing list of the actors, you know, in this film, I think he was towards the end of this. He wasn't one of the top billed the guys in this film. So it's like almost like a, I don't know of his work beforehand, but almost like a discovery. Like after, you know, he was, you know, a second or third pick. And now I think after this, he was probably rose in the ranks.
Yeah. And knowing John Candy and knowing Rick Moranis, I don't think John Candy could exude that like dorky, nerdy kind of thing that Moranis could. And that obviously comes so natural to him from what we've seen of him in, you know, like Honey, I Shrunk the Kids and all that. I don't think that the movie would have the same feel with John Candy in that part.
Oh, no, definitely not. So he sees Dana and he says, you know, oh, I turned my TV on because your TV was on and it was really loud. So I turned up my TV even louder so the superintendent thinks it was me. And so the TV is on in this apartment and it goes back to this whole thing, you know, like with the vertical book stacking. So this ghost, you know, Gozer in the fridge decided to come out and watch TV. Is that what he was doing? Or was it just some kind of like, are we supposed to believe some electromagnetic energy that that person was, you know, putting out, turned on the TV? Or was he actually, you know, out there watching, you know, whatever it was in the 1980s, the Cosby Show or whatever it was on?
I'm not sure, but I would assume that being a ghost and being dead forever, you'd get bored pretty quick and be thankful for TV.
Oh, yeah. And that might be it. Like, he died and he was like, ah, you know, I wonder how, you know, my soap operas are doing. You know, I missed a few years. I gotta catch up. Gotta see what's going on.
You can only haunt the fridge for so long without getting bored.
Maybe he was like a healthy guy and he saw the junk food in the fridge. And he was like, ah, no, but I don't want the temptation. I'm going to go out, sit and watch TV a little bit. Either way, Dana comes in, turns off the TV, seeing the ad, you know, the first ad for the Ghostbusters. So I guess for a movie standpoint, that's why the TV had to be on, so she could see the ad. But she goes, starts, you know, doing the groceries, putting them all out. And then she opens the fridge to hear zoo, and then closes the fridge. I don't even know if we got the full zool. It was more of a zoo.
Yeah, but, I think they faded to another scene, right?
Yeah, I think it goes right into the next scene. So, like, you know, she runs away, or, you know, presumed, but because later on she says, oh, the thing said zool, and, you know, there's talk online, and it's like, well, I guess, I mean, we didn't really get to hear the full thing. You know, we heard half of the word, but all right, I'll take her word for it. All right. So we go back to the fire station now. Things are getting the setup, and we have Egon underneath the desk and setting up a computer here, and turns to Janine and says, "Print is dead." Now this is 1984, and he's just ahead of his times, Harold Ramis here. He knew the future. I almost said Mike. Sorry. It's just so. It's all right. After 68 of these or whatever we're up to, I'm getting flashbacks. But yeah, so he's ahead of his time, this Harold Ramis. But I guess he wasn't, even though he obviously worked with Dan Aykroyd on this, he wasn't the first person maybe in mind for this. There was Christopher Walken, John Lithgow, Jeff Goldblum, and another Back to the Future reference here. This would have been before it, though, Christopher Lloyd. They were all in contention to be playing Egon. Again, it's hard to think about what could have been, but do you think any of these guys could have held a candle to Harold Ramis?
I don't know. I think it would have still been good with maybe Christopher Lloyd, but it wouldn't be the same good. It would be a different good that we'll never know if it's a better good or a worse good.
Oh, yeah. I think the only downside of Christopher Lloyd playing this part, I'm thinking about here, if this came, I mean, he might have had time. If this came out in 1984, I think they were probably filming Back to the Future in 1984, so he probably still could have done both. But it would have really, been a whole paradox if we didn't get Christopher Lloyd as Doc Brown. I mean, can you imagine that timeline? So,
oh, jeez.
So we're just thankful for Harold Ramis, to step in here.
Michael J. Fox was pulling double duty with that TV show, so maybe it would have worked out.
Yeah, who knows? It's also interesting, though, I'm pretty sure, also in Back to the Future, those commentaries, I think Lithgow and like Goldblum and some of these people were also in contention for Doc Brown. So I don't remember seeing Harold Ramis on the list, but I just think that's funny that like all these character types are almost in each other's roles here.
That's funny because I don't think that Harold Ramis would be as good as Christopher Lloyd as Doc Brown.
No, I mean I don't think he was on the list, but like
no, I know. I'm just saying.
Yeah,
I'm just saying it's funny that it doesn't go both ways where maybe Christopher could come into Ghostbusters, but
Ramis
it couldn't go the other way.
Huh. All right. Well, that's a topic for another podcast and a whole another timeline. Maybe in the Dan Aykroyd different dimension original script of Ghostbusters, Back to the Future came out with Harold Ramis. So we can look at that another date. Dana comes in to the fire station here, which is actually kind of confusing to me because Janine said there was no calls. Nobody called in. And there was no address in the TV ad. Now, this is pre-internet. I'm sure it's been a few days, so their address and phone number isn't in the yellow pages or anything like that. How did Dana find this location here for the Ghostbusters?
I have no idea. And
she's just searching the streets, just walking up and down.
Knowing the geography, it's not exactly close to where her apartment is it?
No, yeah, because we actually visited this fire station.
Firehouse.
And I think it was kind of like, it was complete, yeah, wasn't it? It was like way down, like more south than she would be. I think it was like downtown.
Yeah.
So yeah, she must have been, I think it was a couple days later, but like still, she's been walking for days here to try to find this location.
That being said, would you go home if you heard Zool come out of your fridge?
Well, no. I mean, probably not. I'd probably move out of the state, to be honest. Like, I'm that paranoid of, if there's a noise in the middle of the night, it's keeping me up, and it's probably just the sprinklers on outside. But no, yeah. So I agree with her, but still, it's interesting. Yeah, like, I don't know where she just happens to stumble upon this place, but we interview her and we decide, or Bill Murrary decides, that we should maybe go check her out. I mean, check out her apartment, as he says in the film. So that's another quote to add to our list. Right. So you ready to jump to this next scene, which could be my favorite scene of the film, which is high praise.
Yeah, go for it.
All right. So we go back to Dana's apartment. We got Murray and Sigourney Weaver here. And I think the reasons I find this scene just hilarious here is because I can't separate Peter Venkman and Bill Murray, but Bill Murray here, I think, is just being a complete, a jokester. Like, he's just making stuff up on the fly here. Like, he goes up to the piano and just starts playing those two notes. He's like, I like to do this. It tortures them. He's like, he doesn't know. He's making crap up. He's just pulling it out. And he's just, then he's like walking around and he's, he's puffing the like little air thing. He's just really just puffing air into the room, and it's just like, what does she say? Like, are you using that right?
She says, are you sure using that correctly? And he goes, I think so.
He's just like, I don't know. Like, it's just completely, I think Bill Murray at his best here, just, you know, fooling around, just, you know, ad-libbing, just having a good time. But I get confused, though, later on with his, kind of his performance here, because at the end it reminds me of, like, all these, like, romantic comedy cliches, because he's like, you know what I'll do? I'll find this ghost. I'm going to take care of your case. I'm going to do it for you. Like, you know, as he turns, you know, back from the doorway after she's kicking him out, it's kind of like this, you know, I'll do it. I'll show you. And it makes me confused that at this moment, is he actually interested in Dana, or does he just want to sleep with Dana? Because it seems like he's actually almost like more into her than he is.
I don't know. I mean, that's a tough question to throw out there, just because of the nature of his character. Like, everything says point towards just getting with her and being done, but at the same time, this is a little bit of an offshoot of his normal tactics. So maybe he does want to, you know, have something more than just a fling with her.
Yeah, I don't know. It's just really hard to read for me. Like, you know, just because I think of those like cliche, like kind of like things he's doing at the end. Like, it's almost like an improv scene, like going a different way kind of thing. Like, you don't see it coming. Like, it's like, I'm going to do this for you. And it's just, I'm just confused, like, of what his actual intentions are. Either way, you know, we all know the ending. So, I mean, I guess it works out for him in the end. But before we get there, we're going to go to the Sedgwick Hotel. You know, Janine says, you know, yells, we got one. And, you know, they run in. They see someone in the elevator, and it's like, someone saw a cockroach up on 12. And he's just like, that's got to be some cockroach. And it's like, I'll bite your head off.
Yeah, and I believe that's the first time we actually see them with the packs and hear them turned on. And just, didn't they do a quick explanation about what they are while they're riding the elevator? A nuclear reactor or something?
Yeah, I have a nuclear reactor strapped to my back. Too bad we didn't get to test one. And I think he's like, flip me on. And then he turns it on, and then you just see, like, Harold Ramis just, you know, go up in the corner and just is like, ugh. I think that's like a perfect, like, you know, moment, you know, from not saying anything, but it's all in the expression.
Oh, for sure.
So they get off the elevator, and they nearly kill the maid. You know, they're spooked by it. You know, she's I think, nervous, but also, I think she's not too fazed by it, because, you know, she's just still hanging out there. Like, for me, I would have bolted. I would have ran out of this place. She's actually picking up her stuff, you know. Oh, I still got to clean.
Putting out the fire,
I got to clean these four other rooms here, so, you know, can we hurry this up, Ghostbusters? But they decide to split up, because, here's another quote, we can do more damage that way. I just love how Murray says it. He's like, yeah, good idea, Ray. Let's split up and we can do more damage. There's a great YouTube video, I think you found, John, where they calculate the damage in Ghostbusters. For the entire movie, they estimated $10.5 million, or in today's money, $23.6 million. I had to do some rounding there. $23.6 million that this movie cost the city of New York, you know, in this fictional world, to clean up the Ghostbusters mess.
Four guys with some unlicensed nuclear reactors on their backs,
and a whole lot of marshmallow goo everywhere.
Yeah.
So the damage in this like scene alone, you know, for the hotel, $26,222, or about $60,000 in today's money, just in, you know, in their first trial run at this. And it's all because of Slimer. We finally get introduced to Slimer. What do you think of this guy, this ghost?
I remember when I first saw the movie, I was not very interested in it. It was just a fat ghost that ate. But knowing now that he holds such a key role in the cartoons, and I believe he actually comes back in the video game I mentioned before, and I think we see him a couple more times throughout the movie. I think they tried to go for a lovable, mischievous type of ghost, which works well with the characters who are very much in the same light throughout the whole movie.
No, definitely, and supposedly this lovable ghost has been joked around by Dana Aykroyd as being the ghost of Belushi, and it's voiced by the director of the film, who also later does Dana's possessed voice. So yeah, it is kind of, you know, it fits with the group. You know, it's based on a, was supposed to be one of the Ghostbusters. It's voiced by the director, so it's very important to the films.
Sure.
And we actually end up getting Slimer. We catch him. They only charge about $5,000 for all this. So for in today's money, $11,000, you can have a ghost removed. Like, you know, don't worry about the $60,000 that they just destroyed in your ballroom there. I feel bad for the people that were trying to have whatever they were supposed to have there that night. But either way, they came. Well, I'll say it this way instead of they came, because we came, we saw, we kicked its ass. That's the line from this scene. Another great quote as he burst through that door.
They, in the commentary, they mentioned that they did this, that one take where they burst out the door, I think about 10 or 15 times, and every time before they came through the door, the three of them would huddle up and think of something new to say. Somewhere there's a reel with 8 or 9 golden lines that they came out with, and they chose this one, but the director was saying that almost every single one was perfect, and they had a hard time choosing.
Oh man, I gotta find that clip. That'd be a great thing to hear, I think. Didn't you also tell me that this was like, it took place over like 3 or 4 days shooting for this, the scene in the ballroom?
Yeah, they closed the ballroom down for about 3 or 4 days, and they mentioned that a lot of the people, you know, you see in the movie, a lot of people looking at all the bangs and booms coming out of the ballroom. But he said that in real life, people were doing the same thing because it was still a functioning hotel while they filmed, but they just closed off the ballroom.
Oh, man. Can you imagine staying there and you get in the elevator with Bill Murray and, you know, Harold Ramis with all those things, like, you know, going up to set. Oh, we got to go film a scene. They're just wearing these giant, you know, nuclear reactors, you know, whatever. And, oh, just another day at the office kind of thing.
Yeah. Great vacation.
Oh, there you go. All right, so now we got a little bit of a montage. The Ghostbusters are blowing up. You know, they're in newspapers. Casey Kasem, Larry King, they're all over. Now, this song that is used, you know, is made famous by Ray Parker Jr. And just recently, he was awarded a star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame this year. Now, Mike, I'm not Mike, sorry, again. John, this song here, is this worth a star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame for Ray Parker Jr.? Now, it's a great song, but, you know, to be known, I think, I looked him up. He did some stuff with radio. I guess he's done some songs with Barry White. But can you name one other Ray Parker Jr. song?
No, not off the top of my head.
So does that, I mean, we've done 68 podcasts, and at least one of them, I'm sure, was gold. Where's our star in the Walk of Fame?
Give me a few hours, and I can Photoshop it in for you.
All right, perfect. But yeah, and then this song, you know, there's a lot of Back to the Future references today. Huey Lewis, obviously from Huey Lewis in the News, sued Ray Parker Jr. for plagiarism, claiming he copied the melody for this song from I Want a New Drug. And originally, Lewis was approached to compose main theme music for this song, for this movie, but he declined to work on Back to the Future. Isn't it? So many references to these two movies.
They came out so close together. How could there not be? But those two songs are very, very similar sounding.
Yeah, so maybe he doesn't get a star on the Walk of Fame if Vanilla Ice can take Queen's doom 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 doom, and if Queen can get a star on the Walk of Fame, maybe we should be giving Vanilla Ice one too, if he also did, he ripped off a song and put it on, you know, but maybe we can't point fingers here.
Oh, I would be a little upset if he got a star for that one song.
Yeah. Well, I guess actually Vanilla Ice has, I think, two or three more hits. I think that's it. You know, I'm not saying that as a general term. He has two or three more hits on top of Ice Ice Baby.
Yeah, I don't know a whole bunch of his other stuff, so maybe some of that's worthy, but
yeah. At least one more than Ray Parker Jr.
Yeah.
Anyways, so we get this montage. The one thing that sticks out about this montage to me is this. I think randomly in the middle, there's just Dan Aykroyd has a sex dream.
Yep.
Which I'm like, okay. That's. I think he was writing the script. He's like, you know what? Well, this is what I want. And he just starts. Yeah. Like, I remember being in college. It's like, oh man, I should write a scene where I get to make out with one of the actresses. Like, yeah. Oh well, it's in the script. We got to do it. And yep. I think that's. Even though there was no actual contact in this, it was still kind of weird.
It was weird, and again, going back to the commentary track, they mentioned that they cut most of that sequence out. That was the leftovers.
So there was more. Maybe there was contact in the first version.
I have no idea, and I remember that the director was. Unsure of what to tell his kids, so maybe he didn't cut enough out.
Yeah, I think when I was a kid, I was still confused of what was going on. Like, I'm gonna be honest. Like, when I was like six, I'm like, what is going on today? It's clear. I know what's going on today, but like, when I was six, I'm like, okay, this is kind of strange. Like, what is that ghost doing? Like, is he torturing him? Like,
he's
what's going on?
His pants.
Yeah, he's. Oh man, I think we're getting in trouble. This is supposed to be a clean podcast, so I probably should jump into the next thing here. We get to introduce in this next scene here to the fourth Ghostbuster, Ernie Hudson, who plays Winston. Now, I might be a little rude to Winston on this podcast because for me, after rewatching it, I don't know if he has the Ghostbuster's heart. He comes in. He's getting asked all these questions, you know, do you believe in this, Atlantis, all that kind of stuff. And he's like, well, if there's a paycheck in it, I'll believe in whatever you want me to believe in. And then later when they're at the jail, he's like, hey, I was just with him. It wasn't me. It wasn't me. Like, get me out of here. And then he's like, and then later he's like, you know what, guys, no offense, but I'm getting my own lawyer. And he's like really kind of just like throwing him under the bus. And I just thought that was kind of weird. Like, all right, man. Okay, Ernie.
Yeah, here you are on this great team, and you're in it until it gets rough, and then you're you know, backing up, saying, "Whoa, that's not me."
Exactly, and then this might also be this is not trying to be rude, but like I'm saying, is he actually needed? Like I'm just saying, is this fourth Ghostbuster actually needed? Because I was counting the scenes; he's only in three or four scenes, like total, barely any lines, you know. In the whole film, obviously the other three steal the limelight here, but do we need a fourth Ghostbuster?
I don't know. I mean, it certainly was a convenient outlet for the three smart guys to explain to someone who's not smart what's going on for the viewer. But as far as did they need a fourth guy? I don't think they did.
Yeah. And it's almost like they hired him without any, like, questions. Like, I know they were all, I mean, we just saw the montage of how hard they were working. And, like, they come in, they're like, oh, man, the work order tonight, oh, it's going to be such a long night. But then they're like, oh, this is the guy, he's applying to be the job. I was like, oh, great, you're hired. No questions asked. You know, what is he, the only guy to come in? These guys are national superstars now. They're on every magazine cover. Only one guy in the entire country decided, hey, I'm gonna be a Ghostbuster.
Not to mention, it's not like they ever split up and form teams. They're still, it's just the four of them going around. You know, it's like, it's not like they're not divvying it up.
They're still all going to pretty much every event. Like I think there's only one time where I see Aykroyd and Ernie here in a car coming back together as I think. Egon was back at the the station with Janine, and I think Peter was on the date. But still, it's like, for the most part, the four of them do everything together anyways. Like, I guess at the end, when they all had to cross the streams, they needed four streams to cross. Or I guess that was the reason he was there. Like, it was like they needed that much power. But I think originally, maybe we can trace this back to the original idea, and this character was supposed to be played by Eddie Murphy. So I'm thinking maybe he had just more to do. You know, like, there was more scenes with Eddie Murphy, and then once he got out, it was like, okay, let's cut some of these scenes out.
But it was still necessary to have a fourth guy, yeah.
I don't know. I'm guessing maybe he just had more to do there. I think it would have been crazy if Eddie Murphy did, because, you know, as we said, he already had the number one movie.
Yeah.
So maybe if he joined the Ghostbusters, we said they lost by $5 million for the top film of 84. Maybe that would have been the extra push it needed to be the number one movie of the year, but we'll never know. We do get this great scene, though, when they hire him, and they're talking about how, you know, everything, they're working so much because there's a lot of paranormal activity. So much so that if we compare it to a Twinkie, it'd be a Twinkie that's 35 feet long and 600 pounds.
And that's a lot of Twinkie.
Yeah, so we at least got a good line out of Ernie Hudson and Winston, you know, saying, you know, that's a big Twinkie or whatever. Mm-hmm. He says, but you know, I'm not a Twinkie fan, John, but do you have something that you wish was like that big? Like, it's like any food item, or, you know, what is it a monitor for your house 35 feet long? Like, what do you want that's that size of that Twinkie?
Oh, I don't know if I can say it on the podcast.
Whoa, John. You know, I don't know what that is implying either. No, I'm trying to think what I want.
I don't know.
Maybe a house. Actually, no, that's not right.
Yeah, that wouldn't be 600 pounds worth of Twinkie. Would be like two or three humans worth.
Yeah,
you'd be living in a shack.
Yeah. Hey, it's bigger than my house now. Trying to think. How about
gold?
Yeah, gold would be nice.
Yeah.
Maybe just cake, even though that's what Twinkie is. I want like funfetti cake. That's my jam.
All right.
With a 30 feet long glass of milk, so I can put the cake in the milk and just,
there you go,
dunk it.
How about a nice big Reese's for me?
All right, a little peanut butter cup, that works. I wonder if they have any of this food at Lewis's big party. That was the next scene here. So Dana comes back. She has the date now with Peter. But Lewis, it's like she tries to creep along the door, you know, in the hallway here. But boom, Lewis is out. He sees her come. Like, is he just waiting by the door? Like, the party's hopping. It's people are having a good time. He wouldn't be able to hear that. There's no way. So is he just, like, waiting by the door, waiting for Dana?
I have a feeling that this isn't the first time that she's tried to skate past the party, and he knows that she will not come in and is there ready to pounce to say, hey, you know, you didn't come last time, you come this time, you know?
Yeah, like, I don't know, he must be, like, looking through the people or something. Like, it's just, it would have been funny if there was, like, a scene before that he, like, you know, somebody else was walking by, and he's like, ha ha, and he's like, oh, yeah, sorry. Just goes into a whole thing. It's like, oh, sorry, like, wrong person. You want to come to the party too, but
yeah.
But Dana actually, you know, bypasses the whole thing. She gets into the apartment, and now the gargoyles are these creatures, gozers, like statues. I'm trying to keep track of. I believe there's two, right? There's two of these guys, because later on we see Dana and Lewis become them, right?
Yes.
Now, what's confusing to me is, we have one that's clearly behind the door, like in the kitchen. There's something going on in the kitchen. There's one that's in the chair that Dana's in, because, which meanwhile also has three arms. Like, instead of, I know there's four legs, but it's clear that there's arms holding her down, one of which was getting pretty grabsy. I don't know if you saw, but if you're watching it, one of them goes right to her chest and just starts grabbing at her chest. So whoever was that, you know, crew member, it was he was trying that day. But so yeah, there's two in the apartment. But then isn't there also another one already hanging out in the bedroom of Lewis's house?
Yes,
So I'm trying to, I mean, we never see the one behind the door, so it, but it had like the spikes and all that kind of stuff. So I'm guessing there was at least three here. So, I mean, there's no way that there was one in the kitchen, somehow left, went in the hallway, went into the party, went into the bedroom there. That's just impractical, no matter how big that party is.
I imagine there must be a few, even though we do only end up seeing the two on the top of the building. There must be more.
I don't know. But yeah, so she's gone. How many dogs are on her? We don't know. But Lewis, meanwhile, is actually doing pretty well at this party. I was really impressed with this. I don't know why he's trying so hard with Dana, because he goes up to this blonde girl and is like, "Do you want to dance?" And they start dancing. They're having a good time. Like, she was really, it looked like really into him.
He was just doing her taxes, man.
Oh, well, he's got to do it more often, because I think there was some kind of chemistry there. At least something was going on, but I don't know. What was it? This you were telling me this was one take, or like...
Yeah, they had a couple other angles, but they liked the one big long take that they did, and they only interrupted it to show the dog in the room, but when they cut right back, it's still the same, the same take. They didn't, they just cut to a different camera real quick, but it was one take, and it was, I think they said it was like 90% ad-libbed.
Wow, yeah, I mean, he was on fire. I mean, everything he said was great, but to do it all in one take, you know, be just as funny, and to ad-lib this is crazy. One thing I'm not impressed, though, I know we talked about how great the effects are, you know, like the practical effects. Rewatching this dog burst through the door and land on that table, I'm sorry, that is the worst effect I've ever seen almost in cinema, I think.
Yeah, that was
not good.
That was the dawn of the digital effects, right? Yeah. That was just starting to...
Yeah, I mean, it's just so weird, because it's just like the dog's body is just doesn't know what to do with the table. It's just like, it just looks like it's some weird like claymation added on top of a green screen or something. But I know it's 1984, but still, like, you know, I think a couple years later they were doing stuff with in Back to the Future Part 2 with like having three Michael J. Foxes in one scene with like a long take, like.
Yeah, they did.
They can do that, but they can't figure out how to... Even if it's just like a guy in a costume at this point, like...
Oh, speaking of bad effects, jumping forward a bit...
Yeah.
You can actually see that the Stay Puft Marshmallow walks through the church at one point, because they didn't...
Really?
They didn't move the prop or whatever in the right way, and it's in the church, basically, and it's not breaking anything.
That's funny. Yeah. That whole thing, like, you know, talk about that real quick. Is that like a guy in a costume, I guess? With like a miniature set, probably?
I think it was a couple, depending on the shot. Yeah. I think they made a couple of small models, and they had a guy in a suit, and I think it all depended on the shot.
Mm-hmm. Man. Yeah, so sometimes they knock it out of the park. Other times, I heard something that when they originally tested this movie, that a lot of the effects weren't even there. None of the ghosts were actually in the film yet, but audiences loved it anyways. I mean, that just goes to show, you know, effects are not, like, the story's there, the characters are there, so.
Yeah, the pre-screening of the movie, they had a quick, like, 2 seconds worth of the Stay Puft Marshmallow Man walking in between buildings, and they went, the next thing was scene missing, and it did that for a couple seconds, and it went on with the whole rooftop scene, but just that 1 or 2 seconds of the Marshmallow Man, the audience loved it. They were cheering, and you know, it just shows that before they even did any work, that people loved it.
Yeah, I mean, There you go. That's when you know you have a hit right there.
Yeah.
Yeah, so go back to this party here. Louis pulls a George Costanza, you know, when the apartment's on fire, he says, "Oh, there's a dog here. I'm leaving my own party. You know, screw everyone else. It's, you know, me or nothing here." He goes in the elevator, and he makes it down. He runs out of the apartment. Somehow this dog, even though he was alone in the elevator, is caught up to him. Went down all the flights of stairs, which we later know is it's pretty high up there. Because they
23,
had
I think, right?
Yeah, they had to walk up all the flights, and they make a joke about that. So they're high up. The dog somehow catches up to him. And then we get to this, I think, building or this restaurant in Central Park. This thing always bothered me because not only does this building not, I feel like, have any doors, but also they're not letting this guy in. Obviously, he's claiming, you know, he's screaming in terror. And this dog attacks him, like, right out front, and they just go back to eating. No big deal.
Just another day in New York.
It's like, what the hell? Like, I'm telling you, I might not have stepped in and done anything, you know, like, you know, sit, you know, knock the dog out of the way or something for him. But at the very least, I would have called 911. I would have opened the door for this guy.
You would have looked into it a little more.
Yeah, well, sorry, Louis, but, Your dog meat here. You're gone. You're now possessed. But, you know, speaking of possessed, Dana is possessed. As Bill Murray, as Peter comes up to the apartment here, and, you know, knocks on the door. You know, are you the key master? And he says, no. And the door closes. And he knocks again. Are you the key master? Like, yes, I am. And as soon as he gets in, he's like, actually, he's a friend of mine. I'm, you know, I'm waiting for him or something. But I've always wondered, you know, because obviously there's a police investigation going on right now. How interesting or funny a scene would have been if the police came to knock on the door here, you know, because obviously questioning, you know, all the people here, what did you hear? What did you see? And it's just, you know, are you the key master? And the police is like, what the hell is it? What are you talking about?
It might have been one of those cases where they say, okay, and just walk away.
Exactly. They're like, okay, something's going on here. Let's just move along. Nothing to see here.
Thanks, ma'am. See you later.
Yeah. But yeah, so he has to deal with this now. He has to deal with Dana to keep her under control because she's, you know, crazy right now. She's completely possessed. Meanwhile, Louis is being dropped off to the Ghostbuster station. I'm also confused of what this power these dogs and Gozer has over Louis and Dana, because for Dana, she becomes this sexy goddess. She's like, you know, floating around and like this amazing person. Meanwhile, Louis is just plain dumb. Like, you know, like asking him, do you want some coffee? And then, you know, they're like, yes, have some. And he's like, yes, have some. And he's just grabbing, like, random lamps and frying pans and handing them to Egon. And it's just like, I know he's not of this time, but, like,
I wonder, maybe it accentuates certain parts of their personality.
Yeah, maybe. It's kind of like being drunk. Like, you know, there's certain types of drunks, you know, an angry drunk, a fun drunk, goofy. Mm. Like, it's kind of like that. Like, it really captures their inner soul or something like that. So the next scene here, we glossed over it, but we're really going to talk about him now. Peck, Mr. Peck is back, and he's coming back with a warrant now, because after an earlier interaction, he wants to find out what's going on here at the Ghostbusters fire station. Now, you know, he's kind of a dick when he's walking in. We probably should. He's actually kind of a dickless. He's probably a dickless coming in. And he goes, you know, not stopping, not saying hello. He's just, you know, going like boom, boom, you know, knocking. And like, I'm coming in here. And, you know, even though he's actually kind of justified, I still thought this was kind of rude of him to just, you know, barge in here. At least he could have said, I got a warrant now. Bring me downstairs. But, yeah, so I think I've talked to you about this. Even though he's the villain of this film, looking back on it, he's actually probably justified to do all this.
I think he is, but I also think that instead of just going and having it turned off, maybe he could have talked and figured out what it was and maybe not have just been so brazen about, you know, just to shut it down, but finding out actually what it is.
Yeah, I think he went about it the wrong way. I think, you know, he should have been more calm with it. I think if he came to the office and sat with anyone else on the Ghostbusters team besides Peter Venkman, because when he came in the first time, he kind of got this, like, kind of like this vibe off of him. So maybe that angered him. If it was anyone else, I think it would have been more smooth. But, like, yeah, I mean, looking back on this, it's like, all right, there's three guys all of a sudden making money off these ghosts that just came out of nowhere. No one saw ghosts, you know, really, you know, in the last couple months until these guys started making money off of it. And then now they're storing these in some weird nuclear, you know, thing in the basement that could go off, you know. I guess, you know, to protect the environment, he is doing his job to make sure, you know, there's some not crazy bomb going off in New York City.
Yes, but at the same time, wouldn't his job entail assessment and maybe making it so that he doesn't cause a bigger problem? Because then he's worse than them.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that is a good point, because even he brings in this electrician, you know, and the electrician's like, yeah, I haven't seen anything like this before. And he's like, well, I'm not interested in your opinion. But it's like, well, why did you bring him? Because, like, I know nothing about, you know, engineering, electricity, you know, this whole, like, if lights went off now, I wouldn't know what to do. Like, I just, you know, sitting here in darkness. But he brings this electrician to come over and to have him turn it off when really it's just a giant switch. So he could have just came anyways if he's not interested in this guy's opinion and just turn off the switch.
Yeah, I wonder if part of the warrant and the...
Oh, maybe they needed...
The bill was that someone from Con Edison has to deal with the power, because that may be part of the law, which, you know, I mean, we're dealing with a bunch of guys who run around capturing ghosts. Who cares about the laws that much? But, you know, maybe just to keep some sort of semblance of reality.
Yeah, maybe. What's interesting, too, is, like, it's kind of weird to think, what happens if this doesn't go off? Because Dana wakes up from her kind of sedated state because of this explosion that goes off here. Obviously, all these ghosts go back, you know, into the town. We got some weird, like, skeleton cab driver, which I find strange because everyone's actually, like, a ghost. Yeah. But then it's, like, something from Tales of the Crypt that all of a sudden it's, like, are they taking care of skeletons now? Like,
he's actual physical.
Yeah. That was kind of strange. But, like, what was the necessity of turning that off? Like, would Dana have still opened the gate with Lewis and, like, more ghosts and demons and stuff would have came in? Like,
yeah.
Did that need to be opened? Like, the trap there?
It probably didn't, but, you know, it gives us a few good points in the future where, you know, Peck comes back and, you know, Lewis escaping.
Oh, yeah. Which, by the way, watch Lewis again in this scene, because I never noticed this, but in this scene, he's doing so much with so little. Like, as Peck is yelling at him, he's, like, mimicking Peck. He's, like, with his finger, he's, like, you know, doing this whole thing. And then as, like, Egon's holding him back, he's, like, smelling Egon's arm. He's just, like, it's really just random stuff, but it's kind of, like, just funny little, like, moments of, like, he's really committing to this, you know, Rick Moranis.
Yeah.
All right, so now the Ghostbusters are in jail after what they just did here, even though Peck was the one that turned it off. We find out there's, you know, some rituals that were done on the roof, and that's, you know, that's where the portal, you know, is going to be when they made this building. Now, where did these blueprints come from? Did I miss something that, like, you know, because they were all outside, you know, seeing they like, hang on a second when you're arresting me, let me grab the blueprints from the car, and then, like, they just have them in their pocket? Like, what was going on?
No, not quite. You referenced earlier when Ernie was in the car with, I believe it was Ray. Yeah. And they were actually discussing the blueprints in the car at that time when they were discussing the origin of Zool and what they were their research on it. But a cool point was is that those blueprints were actually the producer's new home that he was trying to build at the time that I guess he brought in as a prop.
Oh, okay. There you go. Well, it worked out. Hopefully he's not having any problems with his, his door in another dimension.
He has a few extra gargoyles.
Yeah, there you go. And before we get to the next scene, did you notice the cameo that we got from a 90s sitcom actor?
I did. Why don't you go ahead and tell? Because I forget his name.
Oh, I don't know his real name, but it's Carl Winslow from Family Matters.
Right.
He had like a one line moment here. I can't remember what he actually was on Family Matters. I want to say he was a cop on that too, but he was a cop in this, and I'm pretty positive that in Die Hard he also played a cop. So this guy has made a lot of money being a cop for a pretend.
Hey, well. You can pretend or you can do it for real, but I think you get more money if you pretend.
Yeah, probably. And it's probably a lot safer.
Yes.
And the craft service is way better. all right, so we are, now we're at the mayor's office, and everyone's screaming, everyone's going nuts here, you know. Peck really needs to tone it down. It's like, people think they're seeing ghosts, he's yelling, but... Thankfully, we got Bill Murrary, we got Peter Venkman here, because every line that comes out of his mouth in this scene is a quote that we're going to talk about later.
Gold.
He goes like, you know, Dickless over here did this whole thing and this and that, and then the mayor's like, is this true? And it's like, yes, it is true. This man has no dick. And it's just, and then there's even like throwaways where he just goes like, you can believe Mr. Pecker over here, and then he's like, it's Peck. Like, it's great. And then, and the capper on the whole thing is when they're explaining all the problems that are going to arise, and they're going in a huge list, and he goes, human sacrifice, dogs and cats living together, mass hysteria, and it's just like, that. I feel like that was another good like ad lib, you know, like that last moment there.
It was a scene that didn't have to be there, but is perfect that it is.
No, definitely. Well... And then the mayor asks, you know, okay, what do you need from me? Like, I believe you guys. What do you want? We cut to army men getting loaded into trucks. We got a police escort, fire department. We have all this stuff. And it's kind of funny because, you know, we don't really see them again. You know, it's the four Ghostbusters that go up to the top of the apartment there. I mean... I would have asked, you know, like, what do you need from me? Well, how about, can I get a helicopter to this area here? So we don't have to climb up all these flights of stairs? That's what I would have asked for, you know? Like, instead, it's like, oh, let's just make a whole spectacle of this whole thing and just get everyone in the world. We'll get Carl Winslow to lead a police escort and, like...
Yeah, they were used for, like, basic riot control.
Yeah.
You know?
Which is weird, too, because it's like... I mean, I know, you know, in accidents, people, I guess, like to, you know, see what's going on and stuff. But, like, if there's an interdimensional portal, you know, at the top of this building, are you going to go right to it and be like, oh, I got to see this? And it's just like, you might get sucked into the portal. Like, yeah, I would stay home.
There's ghosts flying everywhere. And it's like, oh, let's run towards the ghost.
Yeah, exactly. But I don't know. Here we go. We got this big showdown coming up. And right out front, before the guys even get in, there's an earthquake. You know, the ground's shaking. What was the point of this?
I couldn't tell you.
It was just a giant fake out. It's just like, can you imagine if this is how the movie end? Like, the four Ghostbusters go into the thing, and it's like, oh, all right, end credits.
And the world was never the same.
And then it goes into the next Die Hard movie. Bruce Willis comes in to save the day. Carl Winslow is already there at the bottom of the Nakatomi Plaza. And he's like, oh, you know, breaker, breaker. You know, it's just, maybe that's what they're going for. I don't know.
Maybe a spinoff, maybe.
Yeah. All right.
But again, with the commentary, they noted that shutting down this one street backed up. It just dominoed throughout the city, and I think they said almost 60% of the city was paralyzed because they closed those two streets right there with the circle,
And that's not a good spot to close down on.
No.
Right around, because I think that's the main road on I don't know much about the city there, but like to cross, you know, from side to side of the Central Park, because obviously that gets in the way if you want to go to the west side or east side, you know, closing down that street there.
Oh, for sure.
That's good. Wow. 60%. All right. So we actually finally make it up to the top here, and we see that Gozer is actually kind of pretty good looking. It almost looks a little like Janine at first, I thought, like the receptionist. I'm like, is that Janine with just, you know, some makeup?
Makeup and a haircut, right?
Yeah. I think that would have been cool to kind of like tie it in, even though like it wouldn't make any sense kind of thing. But like just had like that character play that, like, you know, kind of some manifestation. You know, we get Ray thinking about Stay Puft Marshmallows. Maybe Winston was thinking about Janine. I don't know. They could have done something there. But originally, that was supposed to be Paul Reubens, Pee Wee Herman.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, that was, he was supposed to be in the form of Ivo Shandor, I guess. This guy in a tall guy, slim suit. So he could have been in his Pee Wee Herman suit for as far as we know. But again, none of these people wanted to commit to it. John Candy, Eddie Murphy, Paul Reubens. Everyone's like, no, I'm not doing this. Well,
wow.
You might want to go back and try it then. So it worked out pretty well.
Yeah, imagine if they were all on board, how different the movie would be.
Yeah, very different. I would have liked to see Paul Reubens do that backflip, though, that Gozer does. That would have been something to see. So we have this confrontation now, and you know, they try talking to Gozer, and she goes, are you a god? And then they're like, no. And then it's like, then die. And, you know, like, sparks go everywhere. And it leads to, actually, I'll give Winston some credit here. I talked bad about him earlier. He has another good line here. He goes, Ray, if someone asks if you're a god, you say yes. Like, so that's another thing I'll say from time to time. Completely out of context, but it's just like, I just think it's, you know, it's a great line there. With this confrontation here, I feel like Gozer's spending a lot of time, you know, taking her sweet time opening up this door portal. Like, she's there petting the animals, the dogs don't run and try to hurt the Ghostbusters. It's kind of like she's, hey, I'm almost there, I can open the door when I want, like, they're not going to stop me kind of thing. And that's always the rookie mistake of villains, you know. I would have gotten away with it too if it wasn't for you meddling Ghostbusters. Just open the door, you know.
The power trip, you know, you're controlling the situation when the quick and dirty kill is the way to seal the deal.
Yeah, well, they almost get her, but then for some reason Gozer decides to become a different form. She disappears, and they say, you know, Tru's the destroyer, and everyone, you know, clear your mind. But Ray, you know, maybe because there's a billboard by the roof of his business, remembers the Stay Puft Marshmallow Man, and that's the destroyer. We got a giant Godzilla-like creature terrorizing them. And I'm trying to think here, what today, because I mean, I don't know if Stay Puft Marshmallow is even still a thing now. What would be the thing, I think, you know, in today's, you know, society? What would we see, John?
Oh, boy. A really big Miley Cyrus butt.
Whoa. Oh, yeah, it would be her with the foam finger, right?
Yeah, there you go. Yeah. Just wrecking buildings and being
with the wrecking ball, yeah.
Yeah, it all ties in.
Now, I'm trying to think. Yeah, that's a good way to put it. I was originally thinking, okay, what cartoon characters, you know, like, are on, you know, cereal and stuff like that. So I was like, oh, maybe we're going to get, you know, Toucan Sam or Tony the Tiger, or I guess it was the Leprechaun guy. But then I was like, maybe it's that Trix Rabbit, because he's always up to no good.
Yeah.
Always stealing, or no, that's, was it? Actually, they're all stealing each other's stuff. You know, it's like the Lucky Charms, they're always stealing my Lucky Charms. Trix, they're always stealing the cereal from him. Everyone's just mean to these guys. Maybe that's why they come back for revenge and terrorize New York.
They just want a bowl of cereal, Dave.
Yeah, well, I'd give it to them.
Just a little hungry.
Yeah. And then it goes back to the marshmallows, because there's marshmallows in Lucky Charms. It all ties together. So they end up, the thing they have to do to destroy this is they have to go against what they've heard and cross the streams. And this, I'm surprised Winston even does it.
Yeah.
And at this point, I'm like, if I was Winston, I'd be like, you know what, guys? See ya. Cause that's what I feel like he'd do. And he'd just go back downstairs and leave.
Yeah, cutting his losses and running while there's still time. But no, he stays in until the end.
I guess good for him. And they destroy him. And then we got all this marshmallows. It just goes everywhere. Mostly, though, it conveniently just falls on Peck. Like, it's like in the Truman Show where there's the rain cloud just over Jim Carrey.
Oh, yeah.
It's a giant dumping of marshmallow all over Peck.
When they were gearing up to do this effect, they had 50 gallons of shaving cream to do this. Oh. And I think it was almost 2,000 pounds worth. And the actor who plays Peck asked if it would hurt. Yeah. And they didn't know, so they actually had to do a test on a stunt guy before they could do it on him to see if it would hurt the guy. And it turns out it doesn't, but could you imagine that? You know, that's your demise. You die from shaving cream being dumped on your head.
I could not imagine that, especially sometimes depending on the shaving cream, that stuff could sting after a while. You know, it gets in your eyes, gets in your pores. That stuff is gonna hurt. I mean, there's no way you're gonna be able to cover from 50 gallons of that stuff falling on you.
They mentioned that they use menthol shaving cream, and that someone actually had an allergic reaction and started getting hives from it.
Do you think it was Murray? Because that's another thing. The entire Ghostbusters team is covered with this stuff. Bill Murray has like a dollop on his head, and that's it. Does he like, I'm not doing this. Like, don't put that stuff on me. Like, is he over it? Like, what was going on there?
They said in the commentary that they wanted it to be an inside joke that, you know, Bill, he was so suave that, it couldn't touch him. And it doesn't affect me. But they said that after most of the screenings they showed people, a lot of people thought it was a mistake that he didn't get covered. And you know, they had a technical error. But they were just trying to have a little bit of fun and, you know, poke fun at the fact that Ray, you know, he's this smooth guy and everything always ends up going his way, but it seems to have fallen a little short of their intentions.
No, yeah, I think I could see them, you know, playing fun, because obviously, again, like, the 50 gallons conveniently falls just on Packet, so it's like, you know, it's them joking around, like, with, you know, the cliches of, like, destruction and this kind of stuff. No, I think you were telling me, do we ever see the Marshmallow Man again in any of the sequels, video games, anything like that?
Yes, that same video game, there's a scene, do they call them scenes? A level?
Yeah.
Where you're up on the building and you're fighting the Stay Puft Marshmallow Man. You know, in the movie, it shows them shooting the packs at him, and that's exactly what you end up doing in the movie, and you take him down in a different way other than crossing the streams, I believe, but you do see him again.
All right.
It was a nice toss back to the video, the movie, and it was cool because I believe that was in the beginning of the game, so it ropes you right in.
Nice, yeah, especially it looks like we take care of the librarian from the first scene. We got this guy, you know, the Stay Puft Marshmallow Man here at the end. We got him. Gozer is no more, but Dana and Lewis are trapped in these dogs here. They start pulling the pieces off here, and this leads to one of my favorite lines here is Lewis, throughout all this, he takes off the thing. He's like, boy, the superintendent's going to be pissed. Like, he just sees this, you know, $10 million worth of destruction. He's like, man, that superintendent, ugh. I don't know if he's going to be fixing this by Monday. Like,
yeah.
There we go. We got now Winston's excited. He screams, "I love this town!" Now, because now he gets the fame and fortune from, you know, saving the day here. he's the hero for, you know, at least the next month. And then we get to see them all drive away, and we get another great Lewis moment where he goes, he's like, oh, he comes out. Anybody want to interview me? And then, like, the medics rush over, and he's like, no, wait, I want to go in the car with them. And it's just like, do we get to see more Lewis? I can't remember. I've only seen Ghostbusters 2, I feel like, once, maybe twice. I can't remember. Because he even says, who does your taxes? Like, does he come back for 2 and maybe does the taxes?
Yeah, he actually, at the beginning of 2, they're being sued by the state, and he is their lawyer. And you can imagine how well that turns out for them. But he is, and I believe he starts going out with the secretary, too, in that movie. So he has a...
What about Winston?
No.
Or not Winston, I mean Egon.
No, I guess it didn't really work out for him.
Oh, that's too bad. Speaking of all these couples, so, I mean, obviously we got Dana and Peter. They get together here, and I believe they have a child in the second movie, right?
I believe the child was with somebody else.
Oh.
I think there's speculation that it is with the violinist who... They're talking to Peter outside of one of the scenes earlier, but I believe it's not his son.
All right. Well, it gets me wondering here, because even though it's great that the lead characters get together, I almost think that Dana and Lewis were actually meant to be, because why is it that Gozer, this mythical creature, picked those two, and they, you know, I'm sure they must have had sex, you know, the gatekeeper, keymaster. I mean, that implies that they had to, you know, do something here to open this door together. I think those two should have been together. Meanwhile, does Bill Murrary ever go back to that college girl he was hitting on in the beginning with the ESP? I think those two should have been together.
Who knows? I mean, I believe the second movie is 5 years after the start of the first movie, so I'm sure there's a whole plethora of woman that Peter gets to make acquaintance with.
Yeah, especially if he's you know, the top dog here after this, you know, saving New York City. Maybe we'll get like a Ghostbusters 1.5, like they did the Lion King 1.5. Hmm. We'll get to see what's in between. But all right. And then finally, our friend Slimer, he screams, goes to the camera. But it's weird. Nobody seems to care. Like, you know, I don't know if this was just like a little like joke at the end, but like they're all going the opposite way. You know, going with the car. You know, cheering for them. Meanwhile, a ghost is coming. They don't seem to mind that there's still ghosts. You know, all the ghosts that were opened by this explosion, they're still around, right? They're not just because the portal closed, because they were there before the portal was open.
Yeah, I think the mentality in that scene is more of we've saved the day and now all we have left is cleanup, but that's for another time.
Okay. All right. So, wow, that's the movie here. And before we end things, we got some other little, you know, housekeeping things to do here. We're almost at the runtime of the actual film.
Yeah.
So that's saying something, that we're probably going to pass that, but now, the legacy of this film, we've talked about box office stats, but it was also nominated for some awards. It was 2 Academy Award nominations, 1 for Best Visual Effects, even though some of those visual effects we've talked about here, and the other one was Best Original Song. It actually lost both of those. I mean, maybe the first one we could understand some of it. It lost to, actually, Temple of Doom. But the other one, you know, we picked on this song... Probably didn't deserve a Walk of Fame star for the artist. But I don't know. I think it maybe should have won the Oscar here. John, do you remember the woman in red's I Just Called to Say I Love You?
Yeah.
Well, I know you know the song, but do you remember how important it was to the woman in red?
Not sure if I saw that one.
Yeah.
I remember the song, but...
Yeah, so do we think they maybe should have won the Oscar for this best song here, or do we side with I Just Called to Say I Love You?
I wouldn't have minded, but if they were getting sued by Huey Lewis, at the, I don't know if they got sued at that time or later, but probably, you know, that may have had something to do with it if they coincided, you know.
It's probably bad PR. Like, it was like Norbit for Eddie Murphy. He was up for the possibility of winning for Dreamgirls, but then when Norbit came out, everyone's kind of like, nope.
Yeah.
No more. Two Golden Globe nominations, one for motion picture, musical and comedy, because they have like some weird things for Golden Globes, and also actor in that category for Bill Murray. Now, it's surprising because we talked about all the movies, you know, that came out that year, really great lineup, including Beverly Hills Cop, that was number one movie of the year. Musical and comedy went to Romancing the Stone, which is actually a Robert Zemeckis film, another Back to the Future kind of moment here. And then Murray lost against, you know, Eddie Murphy for Axel Foley. They all lost to Dudley Moore for Mickey and Maude.
What?
Yeah, exactly. Like, I could maybe see Murray losing to Eddie Murphy here, but I don't know who... Maybe I'm talking out of turn here. I don't know who Dudley Moore is. I don't know who Mickey and Maude are. I don't know if that movie has stuck out as a timeless piece as Beverly Hills Cop or Ghostbusters or any of these movies have.
Oh, it's certainly not as household recognizable as those two.
Yeah. And then finally here, the American Film Institute ranked this film number 28 on the top 100 comedies, yet in 2008, Entertainment Weekly ranked it as the funniest movie of the past 25 years. So I don't know if it still holds up. We have to see if Entertainment Weekly does a top, you know, in the last 30 years, if it still makes the funniest film. But that's still pretty good. Number one for, you know, the 25-year span they chose.
Yeah.
Now, finally, all this, you know, all these award nominations, number two film of the year. There was obviously a franchise born from this film. The sequel came out in 1989. There was two animated series. There was several video games. But instead of focusing on Ghostbusters 2, let's talk a little bit about Ghostbusters 3 and the possibility of that happening. Now, I'm pretty sure I know your opinion on this, but John, do you want a Ghostbusters 3?
I think... especially with more recent events, that I don't think I do. I don't know if they could craft something that is on the same caliber as the original Ghostbusters and be able to not pass it off, but present it and do it justice.
No, yeah. I completely agree here. It's, you know, it's... as we said, I think Bill Murray is the Ghostbusters, and when he wasn't going to do it for a while, it was like they shouldn't do it. But now with the unfortunate passing of Harold Ramis this year, I think they should just leave this alone. Now, it's interesting here because, I mean, it seems like Dan Aykroyd has really been pushing it. He's been really trying for this thing to get made. And there's a quote here I want to read. We talk about, you know, how Bill Murray and Harold Ramis and all these people are important to the Ghostbusters franchise. And these are two different quotes I found. He said, "What we have to remember is that Ghostbusters is bigger than any one component. Although Bill was absolutely the lead and contributed to it in a massive way, as was the director and Harold Ramis, myself, and Sigourney Weaver, the concept is much larger than any individual role. Ghostbusters 3 can be a successful movie without Bill. My preference would be to have him involved, but at this point he doesn't seem to be coming, and we have to move on. It's time to make the third one." I don't know. I mean, I think with the original director, Ivan Reitman, he has dropped out. He doesn't want to do it without Ramis. So we're telling me we don't have Bill, we don't have Harold Ramis, we don't have the original director. So we have Dan and, as we said, Ernie Hudson.
Yeah, and
those are our two that we got. I don't think so.
And Lewis doesn't really act in, not Lewis.
Rick Moranis, yeah, he's retired. Moranis,
he doesn't act anymore either. So it's, so many people are just off this list, and it's it's I'm sure it'd be possible to cover for one or two, but there's too many gaps to fill coherently, in my opinion.
Yeah, maybe we get Chevy Chase, Eddie Murphy, and all those guys to finally come back. And no, I don't think that's a good idea. I've seen names that they've floated around. I know Aykroyd said something about Matthew Gray Gubler from Criminal Minds, Ben Stiller, even Emma Stone and Jonah Hill have names been floating around. One of the original ideas was for them to go to Manhattan instead of Manhattan. It's like an alternate, like, hell version of Manhattan. Yeah, I don't know if I like these ideas. Has there been any ideas that have stuck out to you, John, that if we had to get a third movie, you would be okay with?
I remember a couple weeks ago reading that article, that the interview that one guy said where, you know, he said, I didn't write a script for three, but if I did, this is how I would do it. I don't know, maybe you remember that one. But
yeah, I actually, I pulled it up. It's Max Landis, who's the son of John Landis. He had the idea of having several teams, grown up on the franchise of Ghostbusters and, working, kind of like a McDonald's, across the country of these franchises. And the real team, is a bankrupt and pretty much a parody of itself. And this Egon has passed. Peter Venkman lives on, some, secluded island. It's only Ray Stantz. He's in charge, and he's just a terrible businessman. There's an obsessed team that attempts to summon one minor ghost, and it turns out to be Gozer. And each team is almost like a version of the different comedy sects today, where it's you got the Seth Rogen and James Franco team. You have, the Key and Peele team. You have a team like Parks and Recreation. You have those different kinds of comedy to kind of have the different teams. And, obviously this would be very meta because, everyone doesn't want to do it. Bill Murray pretty much is off on his own secluded island. And it's only Ray, it's only Dan Aykroyd in charge wanting to do this. And so that's kind of an interesting, fun idea. But go ahead.
I could see it working, but I'm not going to hold my breath.
No. Yeah, I don't see this happening, and I hope, there was, I think, a little bit momentum until Ramis' death, and then I feel like it's kind of stopped since then, but we'll wait and see. I did hear that Phil Lord and Chris Miller, who actually are a bit of a hot streak right now, they've done both 21 Jump Street, 22 Jump Street, and they've also wrote and direct this year's The Lego Movie, which, if anyone has not seen it, is amazing. So they have, definitely the comedic chops. What I've heard about 22 Jump Street really picks on the idea of sequels and doing the same thing over again, because it's the same plot of 21 Jump Street, but I've heard it's just as good, maybe even better than the original. So, but they have actually, said they don't want to touch this franchise because this thing is it's like Indiana Jones 4. You're touching something that's beloved here, so good luck.
The expectations are too high.
Definitely. And especially
that's the problem.
As years go by, it's one of those things where it's with sequels, it's a year later, it's still hot, it's still fresh, you're still excited. Yeah. But it's years have gone by now where people have thought of different versions in their head and, have moved on. So when they had to reopen it and it's not as good as they envisioned it was, that's not good, but...
Well, what's also interesting is that one Ghostbusters game that I've been referencing, it pretty much almost was Ghostbusters 3 in the idea that the four of them are there busting ghosts and you're the new help, so you're not actually you're not actually playing as one of the four Ghostbusters. You are the new help that comes in to help. Yeah, and it does tie in with a lot of the, previously explored territory, and it does definitely have a lot of new territory. But in my mind, when that came out, I always assumed that was the three, because it pretty much does take place right after, not right after, but after two, You know, it's it. In my mind, it was the continuation. You know, it, the next movie, but as a video game. But obviously, they feel this pull to make or one of them. You know, Aykroyd feels the need to make this next movie. But I don't know if they could do it and make it something that we can cherish as much as the first one.
Yeah, I'm not into it. I'm, you know, as for my, like, you know, Back to the Future with a part four, it's one of those things where, I love to see another adventure of, you know, Marty and Doc. I would, at the same time, I don't want that to ever happen.
Yeah.
And, you know, to ruin anything. And I hope to God, you know, next year, if anything, I could see them, you know, any day now, announcing that they're going to make one for next year, because it's like a perfect 30 years so they can go back to 1985. And, you know, 2015 was such an important part of that movie. I'm hoping, you know, it's been 30 years. It would have been, you know, a big thing for a movie to be this year for the franchise. But, you know, thankfully, with 30 years have gone by, we're everyone's celebrating this movie this year. I've seen a lot of posts about it. I've seen they're going to put it back in theaters for a little bit. You know, we're being nostalgic for that instead of trying to recreate that right now. So that's good.
Yeah, but real quick side, if they ever did decide to make it, I think it would be really cool to dig out the cameras, not necessarily the same cameras, but the same era cameras and the same, you know, practical props. And if they made it in the same style, I think that would go very far into making it more believable and as a sequel than it would be if it was all CGI. And, you know, I'm not saying that I want it to look bad, but, you know, in 1080p, is it really gonna sell as good as the first one? Whereas maybe they can dig out an old camera and have some fun and make it like they used to make it, and people can be that little extra bit of nostalgia right on top, maybe would help them. But like I said, I don't know if it's worth it in the end.
Yeah, I can only be worried, you know, to wake up and see Michael Bay is going to be in charge of, you know, Ghostbusters. We're going to get these terrible CGI, you know, crazy ghosts and things like that. You know, I agree with you. I think it should be this, you know, this classic, you know, hey, we could do this crazy effects that I'm still confused about how they did 30 years later. I think, you know, we got to go back to that kind of, you know, if we're going to make it, we have to make it in the vein of the original two. All right. So, yeah, I think we are just about to cross the time of the actual film here. But before we do, we are going to try to figure out the best quote, if we can. I mean, this movie's chock full of them. Before we go through our nominations, AFI, American Film Institute, had two nominated quotes for their 100 Years and 100 Quotes special. None of them actually made the list, which I'm kind of mad about. But the two quotes are, "We came, we saw, we kicked its ass," which, as you said, was an ad-libbed, you know, line, so that's cool that that made it. And the other one was another Bill Murrary line from the scene, "He slimed me." Those are the two lines that they nominated. So we can add them to our list. But I think we should... I picked three, and I believe, John, you have three or four?
I do, yep.
All right, so, let's see, I'm gonna go through some of my thought process, what made my top three here. I threw out the quotes that weren't said by the Ghostbusters. I said, you know, "I'll tell you what the effect is, it's pissing me off." That goes off, because it's not one of them. Even though I love Lewis going, "Boy, the superintendent's gonna be pissed." That's off the list, too. It has to be done by the Ghostbusters.
That's fair.
All right, so I'll go with my three. These are in no particular order, and then we'll get to your three, and we'll see if we have any matches. All right, so I have, "Back off, man. I'm a scientist. Yes, it's true. This man has no dick." And finally, "If someone says you're a god, you say yes." So I got, looks like I got two... Peter Venkman, and I got one Winston, actually. So, John, do you have any overlap here?
I do, and I'll leave that one for last. But I know this isn't on your list, but it's on my list. It's spores, molds, and fungi.
Oh, it almost made my list, yeah.
It was just a great line. She's showing an interest in him, and he's just like, I collect spores, molds, and fungi. Like bland as can be, and that always, you know, I always laugh at that one. We came, we saw, we kicked his ass. I mean, how could you not? And then the one that overlaps is, yes, it's true, this man has no dick.
All right, so there we go. Cue some sound effect that you may put in here.
Is this true?
Yes, it's true. This man has no dick.
That is the winner. Yes, it's true. This man has no dick. I guess that is the best quote of Ghostbusters, according to us. But it looks like we have a top five here. It looks like we got, between my other two, your other two, we have a top five quote off here. We'll see if you guys agree with these, you know. That's actually a good lead-in to our wrap-up of this Ghostbusters podcast. Do you agree with these quotes? Do you agree with the winner? Hit us back up on social media. We got Facebook, on Twitter, at Dual Redundancy, on YouTube, where you can hear this in much higher quality, as we said, at youtube.com/DualRedundancy. We're on iTunes, of course. It's probably where you downloaded this. You know, while you're there, you know, give us a rating. You know, you can do a star rating, a comment. That really will help us get, you know, out of the dusty basement of the library here, and we can people will find us better with the more ratings we get. And the blog at doredunsey.blogspot.com, which we got a lot of stuff going on. You know, next week John may not be here. We might have Mike back. We might be talking, you know, some Emmy nomination reactions, but a lot of that stuff will also be on the blogs. You know, Emmys are coming up. We're gonna have a lot of coverage of that. Let's see, what else do we got to do? Well, we always thank John on the podcast, even though John was on this one this week. We're still going to do it. So thank you, John, for coming in, talking Ghostbusters with me, and also putting this episode together later before I put it up online.
Thanks, John.
Yeah, well, is there anything else that you want to say about Ghostbusters before we close this up and maybe, you know, think about doing a 30th anniversary of the Ghostbusters 2 podcast in a few years?
Bustin' makes me feel good.
John, I'm going to put you on the spot here. In 20 years from now, will you do a 50th anniversary podcast with me talking about the 50th anniversary?
Don't have to think about that one. I will be there.
All right, sounds good. Who knows? I'm sure future podcasts will hear from me again. Maybe next year we'll do the Back to the Future 30th anniversary podcast. But until next time, I'm David Allen.
I'm John Berwick.
And that's all we got for Dual Redundancy's 30th anniversary of the movie Ghostbusters. Goodbye, everybody.
Bye. Let me tell you something.